be a baseball player who had changed his socks since three seasons ago because it's good luck. You know, we have rituals that we get involved in as people. And rituals are powerful things in our lives. Webster's Dictionary says that it defines a ritual as a formal ceremony or series of acts that is always performed in the same way. It sounds simple, but it's really saying that something is so automatic that it really becomes a holy habit. I remember John Kennedy's father, and he found himself in a situation where all Alzheimer's took over his whole life, and where he could not hold conversations, where he could not remember many of the people around him. They would take him to Mass every day. And while he was in Mass, the priest would start a reading and he would jump in and he would not miss one single word of an entire Mass. Because it was a ritual that meant so much to him that he mastered the ritual until the ritual mastered him. The thing about it is we repeat rituals. We do them over and over again. And we find them throughout history, but we must beware and be aware that rituals can be realistic. Rituals can be unreasonable. Rituals can be righteous. And rituals can be unrighteous. Just because there's something that we do every day does not mean it's something that we should do every day. And so when we find ourselves involved with rituals, it's good to ask ourselves, who gave us this ritual? Why is it here? What does it do to us? What changes does it make in our lives? How does it empower us? We must come to understand that rituals, righteous rituals, have the power to challenge and change us by establishing holy habits in our lives that can remold us when life seems to be falling apart. These rituals, they can console us when our heart begins to break and we don't know how to make it through whatever we're going through. And it can help us to behold what the Lord wants of us. Just by doing it on a daily basis, it keeps us in mind. There's a street here that, you know, sometimes your pastor, y'all pray for him, his foot can get a little heavy on the car thing there, you know, and it speeds up. But there's a street that we go down, and they always have this sign, that electric sign, that spits back at you the speed that you're traveling. It's a ritual. And every time I get close to the sign, I no longer have to see the sign. I just know the sign's coming up, slow up. You know, that's a ritual. It's something that says even when my mind, when my spirit is not locked into something, it becomes so much a part of who and what I am that when the ritual starts, something in me clicks that can change the way I think, can change the way I feel, and change the things that I do. But there is something about a righteous ritual that we need to realize. If we don't understand the why, if we don't understand why we do the ritual, then we will not fully perceive Heavenly Host, great Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. He didn't really understand what was going on. He came back the next Sunday. No one had said a word. In the same click of the clock, everyone stood up and turned toward a blank white wall. And again, we sit in seeing the doxology. And for the next several weeks when he was visiting that church, he realized this was a ritual that was done every single week. But he still could not figure out why everyone was standing up at that moment and facing a blank white wall and singing that opening hymn. And Sunday after Sunday, when the young man came to visit, he learned to join into the congregation, not really understanding why he was standing and turning toward that wall. And after a while, it just got to him. I'm tired of misunderstanding. I'm tired of not understanding why this ritual. I don't get it. I don't understand the what. I don't understand the when. And I don't understand the why behind looking at that black wall, that blank wall. And then the young visitor one day, simply had the nerve to just turn around because he wanted to know what God wants us to do. What is it that God wants us, how does he want us to do it? Why are we doing it? And he asked someone there near him in the congregation, why do we do that? Saying, I'm doing something every week and I just don't understand why. And the truth be told, many times that's the life of many church members in a congregation. Many times we find ourselves as children where our parents or our grandparents will ask us to join in and do something. And we don't always understand the why of it all. We just know we're supposed to do it, but it doesn't seem to mean as much to that young mind as it did to that grandmother. Because the meaning of what they do is not there. If truth be told, that's why many of us don't receive the full blessing and benefits that are being offered to us by God when we come and prepare to share in this day of communion. Because when we don't perceive why Christ communed with his disciples to share the Lord's Supper, that last supper with them, then before think about it. He knew he was about to be arrested. He knew that he was about to be tried. He knew that he was about to be crucified. And out of all the things that you could do before you know you were about to lose your life, you just want to have last supper with the disciples. Jesus knew that when feelings would come up that we couldn't handle, we would need to go back to that moment. That's why when Jesus started that ritual with his disciples, when he was having Passover with them, a ritual that was locked into their history to remember about Moses, to remember about being enslaved, to remember about the freedom, to remember about how they made it to the promised land, he said, we're going to push this a little bit further. When you do this, know that this is my blood. This is my body, my blood shed for you, my body broken for you. And he said to his disciples, do this as often as you can in remembrance of me, a righteous ritual. You see, Jesus knew that when we feel distant from him, as his disciples were about to, we need to share. There's a need for us to share and act and be involved with community attitude that can reconnect us with God's attributes. Jesus knew that when feeling a failure overwhelms us, we need to reaffirm our faith and reestablish our commitment to him and follow him. Jesus knew that when we suffer from feelings of loss and loneliness, that coming together around a communion table could help us to better understand that we are not alone and don't have to face the darkness and the demons alone. When shootings happen in our schools, in our churches, in our communities, that's why they have a candlelight ceremony. reach out to one another. We need to remember what happened. We need to think about what we've lost. We need to take on the love that, that was there. We need to share it with the world. There's a meaning behind the ritual. And that's why we need to understand the meaning of a ritual, the mechanics of a righteous miracle, my righteous ritual, and the maintenance that needs to be done for us to master and maintain the ritual. Being able to pass it on from one generation to the next generation. Our text starts off by telling us, and now, just as you accepted Christ Jesus as your Lord, you must continue to follow him. Let your roots grow down into him, and let your lives be built on him. Then your faith will grow strong in the truth. In the truth you were taught, and you will overflow with thankfulness. You see, beloved, when you read the text this morning, there are three rules that shared in our text that can help us to perceive and achieve what we need to understand if we want to receive the full blessings of the Lord. Many of us receive a blessing, but we may not receive the full blessing of the Lord. I have never met a man more kind and generous than my father-in-law, Ben's father. But there was something about him that always disturbed me in the midst of me loving him, and that is he would let himself worry himself to death. You say, does he love the Lord? Absolutely. Does he read his Bible? I know he does. Does he believe God can get you through it? Oh, yes, he can. But there was a level of fear that wanted him to keep Pam in the house like Rapunzel. And her hair wasn't long enough then to throw out the window. He received so many blessings of God, but his heart did not feel protected. If we want to receive all the blessings and the benefits that God is going to give us when we lock into his ritual, in his righteous acts of love and our rituals, then the first thing we must do is root yourself in Christ and grow with truth and might. Root yourself in Christ and grow with truth and might. You and I cannot receive the benefits and the blessings that God has given us unless our heart is deeply rooted in his truth. You remember watching television when you were a kid, the old cowboy movies, and they would always show in a deserted town big tumbleweeds just rolling down the street. Those tumbleweeds did that because there's only one major root in a tumbleweed. And it's not a strong root and it's not a deep root. And so anytime the wind would begin to blow, that root could snap and that tumbleweed would start tumbling. But compare that tumbleweed to a tree. A tree that's deeply rooted, like one in a major forest. A sequoia tree. As tall as it is, that's how deep the roots are. And no matter what storms they find themselves in, that tree has the strength to hold on. Not because it is so tall, but because the roots go so deep. And that's what we sometimes misunderstand. We think as long as I am large, as long as I am important, as long as I am wealthy, as long as things are going my way, I can be strong. It's not the height, it's the roots. Even in the midst of a strong wind, in our spiritual lives, we don't have to be like tumbleweeds. But each of us must ask our own selves, am I acting like a deeply rooted tree when the storms of life begin to blow? Or do I feel like a tumbleweed when the moment it God gives us when we get involved in a ritual. Not only must you root yourself in Christ and grow with truth and might, but also you must dismiss thoughts of sin with godly thoughts within. You must dismiss thoughts of sin with godly thoughts within. Some of us spend a lifetime with habits that we're trying to break, with unrighteous rhetoric that we say, with things in our personality that we want to change. And we say to ourselves, I'm not going to do that anymore, I'm not going to do that anymore, I'm not going to do that anymore. But that in itself is never enough. We can't take away evil and expect things to no longer be evil. We have to take evil away and replace it with something that's holy. In fact, Jesus told that parable where he said a man walked into a home that was all filthy and infested with an evil spirit. And he came and he cleaned up the house and he threw the spirit out and then he went away. But when he came back, that spirit went back seven other spirits back in that house and they were partying hard. And in the same way, that's what happens to us. If we don't allow Christ to take residence in our minds, residence in our hearts, if we don't live with Christ in all that we do, even if we've taken the time to remove something that's evil or negative, it will come back into our world. That's why our text in verse 8 says, don't let anyone capture you with empty philosophies and high-sounding nonsense that comes from human thinking and from the spiritual power of this world rather than from Christ. Don't let yourself be seeded with thoughts and feed on thoughts and breed thoughts that are from the world that have nothing to do with God's word. There was an article printed in a little paper called the Pentecostal Testimony that I read a while back. And in it, it caught my mind because it was talking about a place that I used to visit as a child. The major part of my childhood, I spent growing up in Kentucky. And while I was there, they would take you on field trips in school. And one of the places this article was about was where they would take us to Mammoth Cave. And to walk into Mammoth Cave, it was a mind blow. It was one of those places where if you said, hey, echoes would go for days. And then you would say things like the tour guide, I wouldn't do that too much about when you could. You don't want anything to start falling down on you. And after that, everything was like. But in the midst of that, there were these amazing pillars that were all over the cave. And when as children we asked where they came from, he explained to us that one drop of water could run down the roof of the cave. And as it was coming down, it would pick up lime from the walls. And that water and lime could drip down to the bottom part of the cave. But one drop would follow another drop, would follow another drop. And in that, it began to make a mound. It would turn into a hill. It would finally look like a mountain. And it started one drop at a time. Beloved, this is how Satan attacks us. He doesn't say, I'm going to change your personality. He doesn't say, I'm going to weaken you in one moment to be a sinner. He doesn't say, I'm going to overwhelm you and just knock you down. He takes a thought of evil or a thought of weakness, or just an unrighteous thought of anger or bigotry, and he lets that one thought come down your mind until it rolls down into your heart and begins to build up unrighteous hills There's a third and final rule that's in our text to help us understand how to deal with righteous rituals, on how to maintain them, how to grow them, how to develop them into holy habits. Not only must we want to root yourself in Christ and grow with truth in mind, and secondly, dismiss thoughts of sin with godly thoughts within, but also we must reach your destiny through divine unity. Reach your destiny through divine unity. Simply stated, whatever your dream is, if it's pleasing to God, you can't do it without God. If you're asking for his help, you must seek to be with God and not just asking God to be with you. As I've said a dozen times in this school, but I think, you know, too many times we pray like a robber who just robbed a bank, and we're asking or saying, oh, Lord, I'm almost caught, and we just want God to drive the getaway car. We are not supposed to say, Lord, be on my side. We need to say, Lord, help me be on your side. That's why our text closes by saying, for in Christ lives all the fullness of God in a human body. So you also are complete through your union with Christ, who is the head over every ruler and authority. Over every ruler and authority. No matter who, no matter what, no matter where something or someone is trying to control what you do, all the power of God is there in the blessings of Christ. And for us to receive the blessings of Christ, of the Lord, we must be connected to Christ. In other words, for the Christian, Christ is like a divine extension cord that connects us to the presence of God, that connects us with the power of God, and brings about the possibility that was only possible with God. And by that I mean, if we are not plugged into the choice to stay connected to Christ, then we will fall in our attempts to believe God's guidelines. We will fall in our attempt to achieve God's goals. And we will fall in our attempts to receive God's grace. I remember reading about a railroad yardsman who was known for punctuality. He would call the telephone company daily at exactly 11:45 every day. And after years of this ritual, one day he called the operator, and the operator actually called in, and she asked the yardsman, why do you call each day at exactly the same time? And the yardsman responded to her by saying, I take my responsibility very seriously. I call you to be certain that I know exactly what time it is so I can blow my whistle at 12 o'clock. 12 o'clock on the dot. The operator came back at him with, how coincidental. I set my clock every day by your 12 o'clock whistle. Every day. Is it 11:45? Okay, now I know when to blow the whistle. He blows the whistle. Okay, now I know what time to set my clock. When you and I set what we are doing based on one another, we can even be off the path that God wants us to be on and never know it. The text said that he is the authority over all rulers and authority. A religious person usually feels that, you know, too often that he or she has a special relationship with the church, or understand that just because we repeat the words of a ritual or go through the motions of a ritual does not mean that we understand the purpose or will inherit the power that's being shared through the ritual. You remember me? We preached about Jesus in the wilderness. Jesus was in the wilderness for 40 days being tempted by Satan. He established three righteous rituals that can help, that helped him to stay focused on God's word, stay faithful to God's will, and follow in the way that God was guiding him. And if you look at what Jesus did in that one passage in Luke 4, you realize that these acts that he took, he then simply repeated for 30 years. It allowed him to stay on the pathway that God wanted him to be on. Throughout his early ministry, when fighting temptation and facing life's trials and troubles, Christ developed these three habits. And these three habits are right there when Jesus was quoting Deuteronomy every time Satan would tempt him. First temptation. Jesus responded, people do not live by bread alone, but rather by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Second temptation, you must worship the Lord your God and serve only him. Third thing Jesus said, you must not test the Lord your God. You are to follow him. He is not to follow us. And whatever troubles and trials you have to face or fight through, like Jesus, if we want to feed and breed views of Christ and the values of Christ and claim the victories of Christ, then when we have to face and fight and even feel like we're failing in dealing with our temptations and our trials and our troubles, like Christ in the wilderness, we need to develop holy habits, righteous rituals that help us to stay focused on and to only follow and to be faithful to the message of Christ, the motives of Christ, and the method of Christ. When you find yourself, when I find myself, when we find ourselves in a situation where we want to respond to anger, respond to hatred, to respond to misunderstanding, whatever comes out of our mouth, whatever's residing in our heart, we need to ask ourselves, is it helping me to stay focused on Christ? Is it helping me to follow Christ? Is it helping me to be more faithful to Christ? I close. You remember me telling you about the church, the church that every morning they get up and they, on a Sunday when they turn and they look at that blank white wall and they sing the doxology. I told you about that young man who would come Sunday after Sunday and he didn't understand that so finally he was even involved with the ritual. He knew when he'd look at the clock and he'd see the click and he'd stand with everybody and he'd turn to the blank wall, and they start singing the doxology. But one day it just got to him. And he turned to this little old lady that was beside him and he said, ma'am, do you know why we keep looking and turning toward that wall and singing that song every morning? And she laughed and said, well, young man, it's almost hard for me to remember. But if I go way back in my memory, the words of that doxology used to be on that wall. But they faded